Welcome to our webinar. I think we can start now. This is our second session for the day. My name is Victoria and I am your host today. I am very happy how many participants are already online with us. Before we start, just a few remarks for your information. Please feel free to type in any questions you have in our questions box. We will answer as many questions as possible at the end of the webinar. And if there are too many questions, don't worry, we will answer each question via email within the next few days. If there are any technical problems, please don't worry. This webinar is being recorded for you, so you will automatically receive a recording of the webinar within the next 2 days by email. Now, I would like to introduce you to our today's speaker, Dr. Elena Mukina. Elena studied physics and mathematics at the Yaroslav State University and has a PhD in physics. She has been part of the NETZSCH analyzing and testing family for over 20 years now and has gained lots of experience in our R&D department before taking over the position of the business field manager of the software Kinetics Neo last year. Elena has been a huge contribution to the development of the Kinetics Neo software, which she will demonstrate today. So welcome, Elena. We are happy to have you here today talking about kinetic analysis and the selection of suitable kinetic methods and models by means of the Kinetics Neo software. I will now hand over to you to get started. So enjoy our webinar and have fun.
So, hello everybody, and today we start our webinar. I think it's really important. It's selection of kinetic method and models. Why it's important? Because you know there are different processes, kinetic processes, which could be analyzed. They could be simple, they could be complex, that could be really very complex. They can have some competing steps or parallel steps, and that's from one side. From another side, there are very many different methods for kinetic analysis. And it is very important to know which method is suitable for which process. And I think that today we start to formulate the rules which method should be used for your process or for which process. Here, firstly, we have agenda. Firstly, we would like to speak about data and degree of conversion for kinetic analysis. Then some methods of kinetic analysis. There are two big approaches, model-free and model-based. And we would like to see what processes could be analyzed by model-free methods, here two groups, single-point and multi-point methods, and then which processes could be analyzed by model-based method. Here we can make a selection of the number of steps, construction of multi-step kinetic model, selection of reaction type for individual steps, and a couple of examples of decomposition, curing, crystallization, and sintering. And now the first part is data and degree of conversion. For kinetic analysis, usually we would like to know what happens inside materials and what happens with materials at the temperature conditions where we cannot not measure. For example, lifetime predictions for wire insulation. Is this wire insulation will be elastic without degradation during a couple of hours or maybe a couple of months or a couple of years. And for example, a coating for gas pipelines or oil pipelines, should we exchange it every 5 years or every 50 years? So we should know this before we apply this material. And next part is curing and cross-linking. We would like to know what happens with our material in 20 minutes or in a couple of hours. Is it still liquid or elastic, or is it already in glassy state? And should we make just wait until it cured completely or not? for firing of ceramics. It's very important to know what is the temperature profile for firing. If this temperature profile gives us a best quality in the shortest time or not. And the last one is crystallization. For example, for polymers, for PET, we can simulate if our PET bottle will be transparent or not during our production process, if there are some crystallization during production or not. Data. If we speak about degradation or lifetime, then usually we use thermogrammetrical data. Here we measure a mass of material during heating, and if some degradation happens, then there is a mass loss. At the beginning, mass is high, and at the end, mass will be low. And in the middle, the process depends on the rate of the heating. If the heating is fast, then we have a decomposition at higher temperature. If the heating is slow, then we have decomposition at lower temperature. If we speak about curing or some process with a constant mass, then we use DSC. And for DSC, again, we make measurement during heating and measure a heat flow. A heat flow shows a peak on our curve if a reaction is exothermal or endothermal. And this peak shows how many energy is produced during our reaction. For example, here, for fast heating, the production of energy is very intensive and it happens at high temperature. For slow heating, it is not very intensive and it happens at lower temperature. The heating is important for chemical reactions, but for crystallization, the cooling is more important. And here, again, we can make fast or slow cooling. For fast cooling, the crystallization is intensive and it happens at lower temperature than for slow cooling. Next very important things for analyzing is a rheometric measurement. A rheometric measurement is important for curing, for analyzing of curing. Here we measure viscosity versus temperature. At the beginning, we have dependence of a reactant viscosity on temperature. Then we have some curing reaction where we have increasing of viscosity and material becomes to be less liquid. And at the end, we have the baseline which shows viscosity versus temperature for the product. And again, our process depending on heating rate. If it's fast or slow, then we have a different curves. The last one is dilatometer. Here we can measure a shrinkage of material during ceramic production. Again, for heating, at the beginning, we have the thermal expansion of reactant, at the end, thermal expansion of product, and the process could be different at low temperature or at high temperature, depending on the heating, if it's fast or slow. Now, there was completely different type of data, but each of them could be recalculated to the value which called degree of conversion. And this value show what part of material is already reacted and or not. For example, for TGA, we have initial mass, final mass, we have the current mass loss and total mass loss. And if you make a ratio, then we have a value which is alpha and which has changed from 0 to 1. 0 at the beginning of reaction, reaction is still not started, 1 at the end of reaction, reaction is already finished. For DSC, we make a measure the ratio between the current peak area to the total peak area. Again, we have a value from 0 to 1, which shows what part of reaction is already gone. For rheometry, we measure viscosity and we measure the ratio between the current viscosity change to the total viscosity change. Here, the total viscosity change between two baseline at the current temperature. Again, we have a value between 0 and 1. And for dilatometer, we can measure the ratio between the current length change and the total length change and have the degree of conversion for shrinkage. And now how to make the solution and how to make kinetic analysis using our software. Firstly, you go to laboratory and make measurement. It doesn't matter what kind of measurement. It could be dilatometric measurement, DSC measurement, or maybe rheometry or some other measurement types. After that, we put this data into our software. We remove baseline. We recalculate to degree of conversion. And after that, we make analysis. There are different type of analysis. For example, model-free analysis, like here, or model-based analysis, like here. And there are really different methods. And after that, we have some model. And this model can describe all our experimental data. And if this model works at different temperatures, then we can use this model for predictions. For example, predictions of isothermal dynamic, arbitrary temperature conditions, predictions of degree of conversion, conversion rate, etc. And now we would like to tell, to speak about what method should be selected for which type of process. Here, the reaction rate or process rate generally could be described by equation where alpha is our conversion, the alpha over dt is our reaction rate. It is proportional, has some proportionality factor. And then we have f of alpha is dependence on the current value of conversion and dependence on temperature. The main theory was done by Arrhenius in year 1889, where dependence on temperature was described by some function which depends on activation energy. Activation energy is the energy which is difference between the energy of a reactant and energy of transition state. For this reaction. So a reactant, the molecule of a reactant must overjump this transition state and must have this activation energy. Again, here, pre-exponential activation energy and reaction type. Reaction type could be different, for example, nth order autocatalysis nucleation or different. Here is a main idea behind the mathematics of our software. And now different methods, model-free or model-based. There are two approaches. One is model-free, which is based only on Arrhenius temperature dependence. Another is model-based, where the temperature dependence could be either Arrhenius or non-Arrhenius. For model-free, there are two groups, a single-point analysis like STM, multi-point analysis, for example, Azawa, Friedman, Kissinger, Rizovkin. And for model-based, there is always multi-point analysis, but here we have several steps, where steps could be connected by different ways. They could be independent, consecutive, or competing. The reaction type for each step could be nth order reaction, autocatalysis, or different, or another one. And a dependence on temperature can be either for according to Arrhenius or not Arrhenius, for example, like Hofmann-Lorentzian theory for crystallization. And now where we can use our model-free methods. Single-point methods are really very important if we measure only one point. For example, OIT, oxidation induction type, where we measure only onset temperature during isothermal measurements, onset of the oxidation. The second is OOT, oxidation onset temperature during heating, for example, DMA rupture or something else. A second group is multipoint analysis. Here, for model-free analysis, for each time point, only one value of activation energy can be found. And therefore, this method cannot work for the situations where we have some parallel processes. For example, for mixtures, where we have several components and each component has their own activation energy. And our model-free analysis has only one value as a result. Therefore, this method cannot be applicable for the mixtures. It cannot be applicable for competing steps, for curing with diffusion control, for non-isothermal crystallization. It has no information about any intermediate reactants, individual reaction steps. Here, the effect must be the same for all curves, and mechanism should be changed at the same conversion. And now let's see how it works for model-free kinetic methods and where they could be applied. The first is single-point model-free method. Here we have only one point, for example, only maximum point of the whole data. All other information is not analyzed at all. Only one point is taken into account. And then, for example, here we have vertical is log on heating rate, horizontal is 1 divided by temperature, and then these maximum points are on the straight line. A slope is proportional to activation energy, and from the slope, a value of activation energy for maximum point could be found. Result is only one value of activation energy. Nothing more is analyzed, nothing more, no any additional information could be found. And again, here it works only for a single point analysis like OIT or for single step reactions, where we know that the activation energy is constant and no any changes during process happens. Here is example of a single point analysis for OIT, oxidation induction time. For example, here, for the temperature 220, we have a time until the onset of oxidation, 35 minutes. For higher temperature, 250, we have only 4 minutes. Then we have all this data, can find activation energy, and then this activation energy can be used to find, for example, what is OIT at 200 degrees C, at the point where no measurement is done. And here with our software, we are able to make a simulation and find that it happens in 3 hours. This is single point analysis. A second is multi-point analysis. But again, for model-free analysis, there is assumption that only one reactant is present and only one product is present and only one kinetic equation is used. So there is no any information about any intermediate reactant, no information about any intermediate reaction steps. And if the reaction is complex, then complexity of this reaction is described by activation energy, where activation energy is not constant, but the function of degree of conversion. So this complexity is described by this part, and here is assumed that at the beginning, for example, activation energy has one value, and at the end of the process, it has another value. And again, pre-exponential factor has also dependence on degree of conversion. For f of alpha, there could be different assumption, either reaction of zero order or the first order. And inside our software, we use the second one. Here, for multi-step method, the different points are taken into account. For example, we can take the value with degree of conversion 0.5. Here we have the red stars. We put them on Arrhenius graph. Here is 1 divided by temperature and vertical is log on reaction rate. Here is Friedman. We have the straight line, we have slope and the activation energy at conversion 0.5. Then we can take another point with another conversion. For example, 0.8, we have another line and another activation, another slope, another activation energy. We can do it for each value of conversion, for 1%, for 20%, for 99%. And as a result, we have a function where activation energy depends on alpha. Here, this is a result of model-free method for Arrhenius approach. Where it works, It works for single-step reactions. For multi-step reactions, where activation energy changed very slow, either constant or changed very slow. But if there are some parallel reactions, then it doesn't work, because for each point, time point, only one value of activation energy is found. In order to apply model-free method, some conditions must be fulfilled. Requirements must be filled. The first, the reaction must be measured until its end. For example, a first picture, here all data with different heating rates are measured until the end. Here, model-free can be applied. On the second picture, the measurement is done not until the end of reaction, just only until the some temperature. And here, reaction model-free method cannot be applied. Only model-based method can be applied. Second condition, it must be a same effect of reaction for all data. For example, for TG, it should be the same mass loss for all data, or for DSC, it should be the same peak area for all data. If it's the same, then model-free is applicable. If it's different, like here, for example, reaction is finished, but the data are really different, and it is very reproducible, and this is not the measurement error. You see, it depends on kinetic. Then model-free is not applicable, and model-based method must be used. Next one, conditions. The peaks must have the same direction. Here on the first picture, they both are negative. Model-free is applicable. On the second picture, the peak have different direction. One is endothermal reaction, another is exothermal reaction. Model-free is not applicable because it cannot work with such situation, and only model-based method can be used. Next conditions, a changing of mechanism must happen at the same value of conversion. On the same picture, we see that the changing between the first part and the second part of reaction happens at the same conversion value of 0.7. Here, model-free is applicable. Next picture contain really measured data. So it's not artificial data, it's really measured data. And you see here the changing of mechanism happens at different values of conversion. And it means that here model-free method cannot be applied, only model-based method can be applied. Here again, for DSC data, total peak area must be the same. We have crystallization of PET. If crystallization is slow, 1 K per minute, we have a very high peak area, 38 joule per gram. If crystallization cooling rate is very fast, then we go very, very fast to glass transition, and we have no enough time for complete crystallization, and the peak is only 2.5 joule per gram. And again, for such data, no any model-free can be applied, only model-based method can be applied. Here, we can do the following. We can apply a different model-free method for the same data and see what happens. So this same data, here are the points, here are the measured data, and these data are fulfilled to all these requirements which were listed before. But in this case, these requirements are not enough in order to be sure that model-free method works well. Let's see. Here, the first, ASTM-698, only maximum point is taken into account. Here is our kinetic equation. In this Azawa method, firstly, integral is taken into account, logarithm, and then linear approximation. And as a result, we can find that logarithm of reaction rate is proportional to 1 divided by T, and proportionality coefficient is proportional to, depends on activation energy. Here, the points, the slope, and the activation energy. We did analysis, and let's see if this analysis work for our data or not. We have created a simulated data with our result, and we can see that simulated data are more or less okay for the first step, where maximum point is present, and doesn't work for the second step, where no any analysis is done. Second is Kissinger method. Kissinger method take a maximum point and make assumption that derivative at the maximum point is equal to zero. Here we have the dependence where log of reaction or log of heating rate divided by temperature square is again proportional to inverse temperature, and this proportionality depends on activation energy. And if we see the activation energy and use it for simulation, then we see again a first step is more or less the same, and the fit for second step is not good. Azawa, here only 5% of conversion taken into account, and again only first part has good fit and the second part has bad fit. Here is Azawa for multi-point analysis, here 0.5 or 0.8, and we can make a lot of different isoconversional lines for different value of conversion. And finally, we can find activation energy as a function of conversion here at the for the first step, and here is for the second step. They are different. And if we use this data for simulation, then we see that for the first step it works well, for the second step it doesn't work well. Why? Because during the mathematics, here is integral exist, should be taken, and this integral has information about a first step during the result of a second step. So result of a second step for this, according to this method, depends on all history, and therefore this method doesn't work well. Here is a Kissinger, again multi-step model. We have a different isoconversional lines. We have activation energy as a function of conversion, and again at the beginning it works and at the end it doesn't work. Friedman is non-integral method, and therefore it takes into it make analysis only on the current value of degree of conversion, and therefore here a logarithm of our kinetic equation is taken, and result is everywhere very well. You see the points and our line have very best agreement with each other. Next is Vizovkin. Here a minimum of the following function must be taken. Here a different heating rate should be taken into account, and the activation energy as a function of alpha is found, and again really very good fit everywhere. And next one is numerical method. It's our own from NETZSCH. Here we are looking for a minimum of the function. This function is a sum of deviation squares between the calculated value of conversion and experimental value of conversion. The sum is over all curves and all points inside of each curve. And here you see again very good agreement for the first, for the second step between simulated data and our experiment. Then we have statistical data for comparison of results. Here you see for numerical Vizovkin and Friedman, we have a very good value of R square, 0.999. We have very slow mean residual. Here is 0.0 and then something. And we have very small value of S, F test, the highest, the best solution has F test 1, and then it could be a little bit high. And all other then have very high value of F tests and very high values of sum of deviation squares, and therefore may not be used. Again, for model free method, the following requirements must be met. Firstly, measurements must be completely. Total effect, total mass loss, or total peak area must be the same. There should be no reaction steps of different directions. Changing of mechanism should be at the same conversion value. This method doesn't work for mixture, for competing steps, for curing with diffusion control, for non-isothermal crystallization. It doesn't contain any information about intermediate reactant or individual reaction steps. We recommend to use Friedman, Wesofking, and numerical method. And we always must to see how good the fit is. A second approach is model-based kinetic analysis. Here, we can see a second part where model-based approach could be based on either for Arrhenius or non-Arrhenius dependence on temperature. And model-based approach works for additional, more complex situation, for example, for mixture of different components, for competing steps, curing with diffusion control, non-isothermal crystallization. Here we can have a different effect for different curves, and mechanism can change at any conversion value. Now, what is inside? A model-based method has assumption that the complex reaction mechanism consists of individual reaction steps. For example, like here, A goes to B, B goes to C. And each individual step has their own kinetic equation. And this own kinetic equation has the own value of pre-exponential factor. The first for the first step and the second for the second step, they are different. Each has their own value of activation energy, and each has their own type of chemical reaction. For example, for the first step, it could be reaction of the nth order, and for the second, it could be reaction with autocatalysis. Here, we assume that activation energy is constant for each individual reaction step. Here, for model-based approach, the customer or the user who works with our software must select the following. Firstly, a multi-step model, how many steps and what is connection between steps, what is the reaction type for each step, and what is the temperature dependence, if it's Arrhenius or non-Arrhenius. For non-Arrhenius, we use Hofmann-Lorentzian for crystallization. For individual reaction, for example, for two-step reactions, we have a reactant, initial reactant, intermediate reactant, final reactant, and we have the activation energy as the, for the first step and the activation energy for the second step. So here there are really activation energy for each individual step. And after that, inside the software, we can show a step for the first, the peak for the first step and the peak for the second step. And then the sum for both reaction steps. What's important that these peaks are non-independent. It's not just mathematical sum of two reactions. Here, A goes to B, B goes to C, and a second step really depend on the first step. Here, the steps could be connected by the following way. They could be independent from each other. For example, from mixture of independent components. They could be consecutive if we have a complex mechanism where only one component react by different steps. And there could be competing where we have one reactant and the process could be done by different pathways with really different products. For example, A goes to B for high heating rate and A goes to C for slow heating rates. And now let's select a number of steps and see if there are competing steps in our reactions. Firstly, you should see how many peaks are there in DSC or first derivative of TG first derivative of dilatometer measurements, and we can see how many steps are there for dilatometer or TGV. So if we see only one peak and everywhere final final value or total mass loss or total peak area is the same, then we have usually single step reaction. If all isoconversional method lines are parallel for Friedman analysis and the activation energy is constant from the beginning of reaction to the end of reaction with conversion from 0 to 1, then we have single step reaction and only one step must be applied. If we see several steps on TGA data, if we see several peaks on DSC data, then we should apply several steps for our model. And a number of steps should correspond to number of peaks which we see. So if we see three peaks, then we should have only three reaction steps. If you know from the chemistry that there are maybe five different intermediate steps, but you cannot see them here, then you cannot analyze them. So probably they exist, but there are some limiting steps and some additional steps are not fry, and you have no information here from thermal analysis, and therefore you may not analyze them. Again, you must select a number of steps which you see. Here, for example, consecutive steps. If we have only one step on TG, and then we should select single step reaction. If we have two steps, like here, then from the shape of the curve, it's impossible to find if there can be if they're independent steps or consecutive steps. In this case, we should know if the decomposition of one component, A goes to B, B goes to C, or is it a mixture of two independent components? Then it should be two independent steps. Here, the last picture, there are three steps. And if we have only one component, then A goes to B, B goes to C, C goes to D. If we have a mixture of two components, then we have two pathway, independent pathways. And if three, then three. Then we can select if there is really multi-step reaction. So if the activation energy changed a lot during our process, for example, from 100 to 250, then it's really complex process. If we have complete reaction, but the final effect of our process is different for high heating rate and for slow heating rate, then there could be some competing reactions. For example, here for high heating rate, we have A goes to B, for slow, we have A goes to C, and for intermediate case, we have a mixture of products B and C. How it could be modeling? If we have only one step but different results, then we have one pathway with two competing steps. If we have something like this, one step here at the beginning and with the same product, and then we have different products, then it could be a different modeling. If we have only one component, then we have A goes to B and then competing B to C and D. If we have a mixture, then A to B is our first step and C to D and E is independent for the second component. And here is the last picture where we see the competing at the beginning and then no competing at the end. Again, here we can compare our data statistically. And if we would like to see how many steps do we need, so the number of steps must correspond to the number of visible peak and shoulders. The additional competing steps must be inserted into total effect If total effect depends on heating rate, and the model with n plus one steps must be compared with the model with n steps according to F-test here. Inside a software, there is a possibility to add one following step, like here, to make one competing step, like here, and to add independent step. You can create visually any complexity of model without any limitation. For example, you can create one model, select any step, and for this step, you can add one consecutive step, or you can remove this step, or you can add the additional competing step or independent step. Here, the last point is reaction type for individual steps. The first step can be analyzed and found from the shape of the curve. If you make Friedman analysis, then at the beginning, we can see our curves and we can see isoconversional lines. If a slope for isoconversional lines is less than the slope of measured lines, then we have acceleration. If the slope of measured lines is here, is less than the slope of isoconversional lines, then we have retarding, mostly is diffusion, because of diffusion. And if a slope of both lines is the same, then we have reaction of the nth order. But it could be done not always, but only for reactions for the first step of our data, and for all other things we should take into account what is the process. For decomposition, f of alpha is usually nth order reaction. N can be equal to 1 or 2, it could be not non-integer, for example for phase boundary reaction. For curing, f of alpha is usually a reaction without a catalysis. In the literature, there is Kamal-Soror with two different pathways A goes to B, where the first is nth order reaction and another is a reaction without a catalysis. We have it inside our software. Then we have simplified case where activation energy for both pathways is the same. Then we have Cn, where the acceleration because of autocatalysis has only the first order, and we have BNA reaction of Proud-Tompkins where only one autocatalytical pathway is present. Here's example of an autocatalytical model for monofunctional epoxy with CN type. Sorry, recommended data. Recommended analysis without a catalysis. Recommended reaction types C1, CN, CMN, and KS, Kamal-Soror. If you don't know anything, then please use CN. The next is rheological data. For rheological data, we have the dependence on viscosity on temperature before reaction and after reaction. And here the increasing is our reaction. During analysis, we must remove the baseline for reactant and for product, for example, tangential baseline. And after that, we can apply modeling with autocatalytical reaction type. So here we apply the rheological, the oscillational rheological measurement. Here we have measured data. Here baseline is removed. Data are prepared for analysis. And here we have single step model for this data. Second is a two-step curing of adhesive. Again, we have oscillation rheometer. Data with 5K per minute and with 2K per minute. Here, the first picture is experimental data, and two other pictures are our modeling, the data for viscosity and the data for conversion. Points are experimental data and line is our modeling. Here is a curing with diffusion control. You know that for polymers, there is a glass transition. And if material below glass transition, then it's in glassy state and curing is slow. If material above glass transition temperature, then it is in a rubbery or liquid state and the curing is fast. And there are two different mechanisms of curing. The problem is that the glass transition is not on the constant temperature, and during reaction, it goes from low temperature to high temperature. In this case, for modeling, we must know glass transition temperature for uncured material, where conversion is equal to zero. We must know glass transition temperature for cured material, where conversion is equal to one. And here we have some experimental points, and we must take them into account in order to know if our curing goes above glass transition or below glass transition. Here are experimental data. First is DSC data. They are scaled from 0 to 1. Second are picture is conversion versus temperature for different heating rate from 0.2 to 5 K per minute. Here at the beginning, reaction goes fast because material is above glass transition and it is liquid. And reaction goes really fast. Then here, where we have star, we have vitrification, is a crossing of between the sample temperature cross the glass transition temperature. And after that, material is in glassy state and reaction goes very, very slow. And you see that these points of vitrification, they have not the same position for different heating rates. And it means that here no any model-free analysis could be used, only model-based analysis. We should select a diffusion control in our software. The second picture is crystallization kinetics. If we make a heating of polymer, then we have three effects: glass transition, cold crystallization, and melting. If you make a cooling, then we have crystallization only and glass transition again. If you would like to analyze crystallization, then we must take into account that crystallization happens only between glass transition and melting. Above melting, everything liquid, no crystallization happens. Below glass transition, or just a little bit below, much more below glass transition, everything is in glassy state and again no crystallization happens. And now let's see what method could be used for crystallization. First is Arrhenius approach. The Arrhenius approach works at the points just a little below melting point. And it works only for isothermal crystallization. If you make cooling, then crystallization is at another temperature, and therefore we should use non-Arrhenius approach, and it is Hofmann-Lorentzen approach, and it covers complete temperature range between glass transition and melting. For crystallization, again, for a dependence on alpha, for reaction type, we can apply either Avrami nucleation or Shestak-Berger nucleation. For dependence on temperature, there are two approaches: Arrhenius, which works only for isothermal crystallization and very small temperature range, and another is non-Arrhenius, which works for Hofmann-Lorentzen theory. Model-free is only Arrhenius. Let's see where which method could be used. If we use isothermal crystallization, then Arrhenius approach works very well, either model-free or model-based with Avrami reaction type. You see everywhere very good fit. This is isothermal crystallization of polyamide 12. If we make non-isothermal crystallization for PET, you know this picture with a different areas for different cooling rates. Then we should apply non-Arrhenius approach. And the non-Arrhenius approach contains Avrami nucleation for reaction type and Hofmann-Lorentzen theory for dependence on temperature. And it's called Nakamura crystallization inside our software. This Hofmann-Lorentzen theory depends to has two parts. The first is diffusion term. It depends on the glass transition and show that there is no viscosity flow below glass transition. Second part is nucleation term. It has dependence on supercooling, where delta T is a difference between melting temperature and our current temperature. And this Nakamura model can be used for our PET data and can describe not only different shape of the curve, but can describe also a different peak area. And it's very, very important. And here, the first picture is our experimental data and simulated data. And a second is picture is a simulated data for conversion. Another model which could be used for the case where Nakamura doesn't work. Here, we have PBT for cooling. And use Nakamura, it is Avrami plus Hoffman-Lauritsen, it's Nakamura. It has very good fit during the cooling for high temperature at the beginning of the crystallization, but it has very bad fit at the end. And it is not the only polymer with such behavior, and if you open literature, then you can find that the Nakamura model works not good at the end of crystallization for many polymers. And now we apply a model which was published by Nicolas Pirazzoli, and here instead of Avrami, Shestak-Bergeron crystallization was used together with Hoffman-Lauritsen, and here we have a perfect fit. Again, here for crystallization, we have four different type of modeling. We have models which are based on Arrhenius, Avrami plus Arrhenius, Shestak-Bergeron plus Arrhenius. They work for isothermal crystallization in small temperature range. A second is Hoffman-Lauritsen theory. Here, Avrami plus Hoffman-Lauritsen and Shestak-Bergeron plus Hoffman-Lauritsen. It works for both isothermal and cooling crystallization. And here is a last example, is sintering of aluminium oxide. We have three data at different cooling, at different heating rates. You see that the data are not measured until to the end. It is typical for sintering because sometimes it's technically impossible to measure to the end of the sintering. It's a first point. And a second point, sometimes a result depends on heating rate. And here, if we go to the first derivative, then we see four peaks and three peaks and one shoulder. And then we can select four-step model, and we have very good agreement everywhere between points, our experimental data, and line, our simulated data. All our data and all our equation and kinetic parameter could be exported from our software, so you can see them and how it works, and all equations for each step is present here. And again, we have model-free analysis, single point, multi-point, which is not used for mixture competing steps, diffusion control, non-isothermal crystallization. And we have model-based, which works for mixtures competing step, curing with diffusion control, non-isothermal crystallization. All these things are written in kinetic analysis for in ICTAC kinetic committee recommendation for analysis of multi-step kinetics. So we write here all this information. So if you would like to get additional information, you can read this article. And now, please, your questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Elena, for this great presentation. I would directly start with the first question. It is, could you tell me how I can check if model-free kinetics is applicable for my process?
So again, firstly, you must check if your data fulfill all requirements which is listed here. So it must be the same effect of reaction, for example, mass loss or peak area. It should be the data must be measured completely, and the changing of mechanism should happen at the same value of conversion. It's the first thing. The second, the easiest way, just to see if the fit okay or not okay, because sometimes in the literature, you know, only activation energy is found and that's all, and no any fit is present. And if the fit is not present, we cannot say if it's correct or not. Please see the fit.
Okay, thank you. The next question, what method do you recommend for simulating of sintering processes?
So for sintering processes, we recommend to use model-based method, because model-free doesn't work here. And for model-based method, usually it's at least four steps, one after another. The first two of them are usually reactions of nth order, and after that, during sintering, some recrystallization and crystal growth happens, and therefore the last one or two steps could be, or usually, reactions of Avrami for nucleation and crystallization.
Okay, thank you very much. The next question, can users edit the reaction equations by themselves?
Reaction equations, no. Here we have no limitation in modeling. You can select any number of steps and any combination of steps. Therefore, you don't need your chemical reaction. You don't need mathematical equation. And for the reaction types, we have about 18 different reaction types with autocatalysis for nth order, phase boundary reaction, different diffusion reactions, different crystallization reactions. So up to now, it should be enough, but if you really need some new reaction, then you can write me and we can implement it as a new reaction type.
Thank you very much. The next question is, what would be the right reaction type for free radical polymerization, like for example, in acrylic adhesives, which have chain-wise polymer growth?
We have such experience, so we have already measured in our laboratory the acrylic polymerization, and it was for photo DSC with the UV lighting, and we did analysis, and it was presented on NETZSCH conference some years ago. And for acrylic polymerization, it was again autocatalytic reaction type, the reaction type with acceleration. So we have two types of reaction types with acceleration. One of them autocatalytic, and another one is a reaction of Avrami for crystallization. Both of them has acceleration, and for acrylic type, the acceleration is present, and for analysis, we use autocatalytic reaction type.
Okay, thank you very much. The next question would be, what are the advantages of integral methods over Friedman method of EA determination?
Advantages. Yes. I would say disadvantages. So disadvantages, you have shown that the information about history at the beginning of reaction has the influence to the last steps, and therefore the last steps are not good. That is the main disadvantage, and from advantages, I can say maybe more stable results for activation energy. It is the only, but you must take into account that there should be not very complex reaction, and maybe for single step reaction, Ozawa or integral methods works better than the differential methods like Friedman, because Friedman has more noisy result and Ozawa has more stable result. But again, it works for single step reactions or for reactions where the activation energy changes is very slow and very small.
Okay, thank you very much. And I would say the last question for today's session is, are there any applications of this method to oxidative decomposition? This question came 5 minutes ago. I'm not sure about which method it is.
I think I will answer per email.
Okay, yeah. So I would just come to an end in this session. We have many, many more questions here. They are very long and very specific. I think Elena will come back to you by email the next few days and will answer all of your questions afterwards. So from my side, thank you so much for your patience and for your participation in our webinar. It was very nice, and I hope we can see you next time. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you, and I would get all your questions, and I will answer all of them per email. And thank you very much for your time, and I hope this webinar will be helpful for you. Thank you. Bye.